Hello, you're watching a Shogun 2 Total War Fall of the Samurai tutorial video. In this video I'm going to go over pretty much the complete basics of everything, the complete basics of multiplayer. It's going to be a lot like the tutorial videos I made for Shogun 2 Total War, the vanilla version without the expansion, except this is pretty much going to be for the Fall of the Samurai expansion. If you already played multiplayer a decent amount, you already know a lot of the basics, you probably won't benefit too much from this video. After this one though, I'll be putting out another one with more advanced topics. You'll benefit from that probably, so I would probably not watch this and just watch the next one. But well, I'll just go over the things I'll discuss in this video and you can decide for yourself if you want to watch it or not. Pretty much I'm just going to go over everything a beginner needs to know. I'm going to go over how to navigate the multiplayer menus, and I'm going to explain what everything is. I'm going to show you how to create an avatar. I'm going to show you the best way to approach conquering the clan map, or the avatar map. I'm going to show you the best ways to wisely spend your first couple avatar skill tree points. I'm going to show you the best retainers that you can unlock from the avatar map and use right away in your armies. I'm going to show you an army you can use right away when you first start out and, you know, still be competitive with. And I'm going to show you an example battle, 5k funds with a beginner's army. And I'm going to show you how to use an army that you can pretty much use right away from the units and retainers you have available to you and still compete with. So you decide if you want to watch this video or not, but let's get right into it. When you load Shogun, this is the screen you're going to see. I would suggest going into options first. Adjust the graphics to something that you feel is comfortable for your computer. If you're not sure where your computer is at, I would start with low, and then, you know, after a while, if you don't have any problems when you're playing, maybe move up to medium. Don't have any problems while you're playing, move up to high, and then so on. You know, just find out where your computer is at and what it can handle. Then you can go to sound. You know, if the sound's too loud for you in any particular area, you can adjust the volume accordingly. Then you can go to controls. If there's anything you want to change in the controls, you can do it from this menu. Over here you see the camera menu. You can adjust the mouse speed and the rotation speed. For example, in naval battles, I like to move my movement speed all the way up, just because the naval battle maps are so big, you'll benefit greatly being able to move your camera a lot quicker. Whereas in land battles, if I had it turned up all the way, it would just be way too quick for me. You know, it would just be unrealistic to have it move so quickly. It would actually be counterproductive when controlling the units. But in naval battles, you would benefit from having it movement speed turned all the way to the highest. And you can also adjust your camera. Standard camera, classic Total War camera, find out which one you prefer. There's also a third camera option which isn't available from this menu here. It's pretty much a debug camera. Both of these cameras, they restrict how far up you can move the camera and how far down you can move the camera. With the debug camera, you can move it as high as you want, so you can see the entire battlefield. You can take really weird angles with it. You can take your camera inside buildings and walk around the rooms and just do all different kinds of cool things with it. I would definitely suggest the third camera option, which is not in this menu, to unlock this camera. I'll explain it the best I can. If you don't understand the way I explain it though, just Google Shogun 2 Total War debug camera, or Shogun 2 Total War unlock camera, or just mess around with the terms until you find a set of instructions on how to unlock the debug camera. Or if you're having trouble, just make a comment below and I'll give more detailed steps on how to do it. Off the top of my head though, I think you go into you know, your local disk, then you go to users, then you go to your username, then you go to app data, and then roaming, or maybe it's roaming and then app data, I'm not sure. And then you go to the Creative Assembly, and then you go to Shogun 2, then you go to scripts, and then you open up the file called preferences.cfg and you open it with Notepad. It'll bring up a whole bunch of text. You can hit Ctrl+F and then search for, or just find it in the text yourself. It's probably like half a page down. You'll find camera underscore, or you'll find default underscore camera, and then a number after it. It'll be one or two. One of these is one. One of these is two. I mean, it'll be zero or one. One of these is zero, and one of these is one. I forget which one. You want to change that number after default camera to two, which is the number which will use the third camera option not available here. So you change that number to two. Then you click File, Save, you save it, and then when you load up Shogun and you play your battles, you'll have this third camera option, which is so much better. But sometimes if you change anything in this menu when you have that third camera on and then click Accept, it'll actually revert it back to one of these two cameras. Or sometimes if your game crashes and when you load back up, it'll revert back to the regular camera. So once you find that file, I would maybe create a shortcut to it on your desktop. That way, if it ever reverts back to the old one of these cameras, you can quickly find that file and change that value to 2 again and then save it. That way you can use this third camera option. Over in Battle Interface, you'll see floating flags are pretty much these little floating flags above your units. I would keep them on. It makes everything easier to see. You know where all your units are. You know, it just makes everything more visible and easier to control. Same with all the selection markers, path markers, target zones. They're just things which make it a lot easier for you to see what all's going on and control your units, and just gives you a better idea of what's going on in the battle. I would leave them all on. The only reason I would turn any of these off is maybe if, you know, you're a realist buff, you want it to look as realistic as possible, or you're doing it for cinematic purposes, and then maybe turn this stuff off. I'll normally leave them on if you're just a casual player and you want to benefit the most. You know, these will all help you win your battles. Makes everything easier to see and control. Unit info, I normally keep it off, but I would suggest you turn it on, though. Pretty much what it does is when you can scroll over a unit on the battlefield or a unit card, it'll bring up a little box which will display all that unit's stats. It'll tell you its attack value, its charge value, its morale value, and any special abilities it has. And that can come in really handy, you know, knowing how powerful all of your enemy's units are. And, you know, it'll show you also do the same thing for your units, you know, how powerful your units are. It'll really help you out when you're formulating your plan for the battle. You know, I can normally tell, I pretty much got all the values basically memorized, and just by looking at how many upgrades a unit has, I can basically, you know, as long as he's a common player, I already know where you put those upgrades, and I already know pretty much to have everything memorized, and I just don't like the little box that pops up getting in my way and in my view, and I just find it a tidbit annoying, so I normally turn it off, but I would suggest you turn it on. So that's pretty much this for the options. Over here is an encyclopedia, you know, just gives a little description of everything. Maybe give that a read over if you want. And if you're first starting out, this is the first time you ever played, you know, Total War or Shogun 2 Total War, maybe play a tutorial first, give you a good idea of how to do some things. It's mostly, you know, oriented towards, you know, controls and pretty much the campaign. And I would also suggest probably just, or you could also do a couple historical battles first. It's pretty much just like a battle against an AI computer opponent in a historical setting. And then custom battles. You can actually do this in multiplayer too, but unlike in multiplayer, if you're just starting out, you only have certain units available to you. If you do a custom battle, you'll be pitted against an AI opponent, and you'll be able to choose any of the units you want. Well, you can still do it in multiplayer too, in classic mode, but yeah, custom battle, you have all the units available to you right away. You can play against a computer opponent, pick the computer's army, pick your army. And I never really do custom battle, but that option's there for you if you want. Battle replays, it'll show you if you save any of your battle replays. This is where you'll go to watch them. You'll click on battle replays, and then you'll open up the file, and then you'll watch the replay. If you're first starting out, maybe do a campaign first. This is what Shogun 2 is all about, really. This is what Total War in general is all about. You know, all their attention goes towards their campaigns, and it's really nice. I don't play too many I play for the challenge of playing against a, you know, a real opponent, another human being controlling an army. You'll get a lot more challenge out of that than playing against AI, that's for sure. But, yeah, a lot of their attention goes towards campaign, and it's really nice, so maybe play campaign first. But yeah, this tutorial is all about multiplayer, so this is what we're going to discuss. It's mostly about multiplayer avatar conquest. There's another option here though called multiplayer campaign, which pretty much allows someone on your team, or you'll be playing against someone in a campaign setting. It has a couple problems with desyncs. It's pretty fun though. You might want to try this out if you want. If you're a campaign player, it's pretty much just like a multiplayer version of a campaign. It's limited to one other person though. You'll play with one other person either on the same side as him, like a, sort of an alliance, or you'll be playing with him as your opponent, and you'll have objectives, and yeah, it's fun. Maybe try that out if you want, but this is all about Avatar Conquest, which is what I'm going to be discussing. So you load up Avatar Conquest. Let's see here. Oops, I forgot to delete this thing. Alright. This right here is the screen you're going to see when you first load up. You don't have any avatars yet. I obviously already have some avatars. You're going to need to create an avatar. So you'll create an avatar for Fall of the Samurai. And the first thing you're going to see is this page here. You're going to get to choose, the color scheme. And, just choose what he looks like. So you'll just go through the different settings. Find something that you think looks cool. Let's get a mask gray horse. Let's get a different set of pants. I like that katana, I think. Let's name him something cool. Name this one BadEgoGM. My YouTube name. Let's give him a color scheme too. Gold and red. My school colors. Red's also my favorite color too. Let's get a little darker on the gold. Alright. That's good enough for me. Find something you like. Click accept. And then this is the next page you see. This right here is your flag. This is what's going to be floating over all of your units on the battlefield. So maybe choose something that looks cool. This color scheme for your flag, it'll be pretty much what you chose for the color scheme for your general, but you can change it up differently if you want. I'll just leave mine how it is, but if you want to change it, the same thing for doing it for the avatar. Just go through and change the colors and stuff like that. You can handwrite some values in there if you want. And also choose a symbol that will appear on your flag. This is the symbol I like to use for Fall of the Samurai. Find something you like, and then you're done with all that right there. Now this right here, this is where you start on the battle map. On the avatar map. I would suggest starting with number 1, because if you start with number 1, you'll start with Red Bear. Pretty much the same thing. You'll start with all the... It's pretty much just dictates where on the map you start, and I would suggest starting with 1, because the difference is, if you start with 1, you'll get Red Bear gun units, and if you start with 2, you'll get White Tiger Force gun units. White Tiger Force, completely useless gun unit. I would never use that unit, really. But with number 1, you'll start with Red Bear, which there's 3 bear gun units. There's Red Bears, Black Bears, and White Bears. People normally prefer using white or black bears. I prefer black bears. A lot of people like white bears. Not too many people use red bears, but red bear is still feasible. And you'll start with red bear right away, and you'll actually start close to the provinces you need to unlock white bears and black bears, actually. So you'll be able to get the white bears and black bears right away, pretty much, and you'll start with red bears, which is completely doable. Whereas if you start with number 2, all you're going to have is the White Tiger Force gun units, which I wouldn't even use. So really, technically, you don't have any gun units that are competitive. So pretty much if you start with number 2, your first couple battles are going to be fought with nothing but, swords, spears, and cavalry. You really don't have any gun units you can use. You can still, it's feasible. And the benefits of starting with number 2 is actually you're next to a lot of the better provinces. Whereas if you start with number 1, you'll start with a better unit, the Red Bear, and you'll be in a better position to win battles right away. But, there's not too many good retainers over here. You're mostly going to have to work your way all the way over here towards number 2 to get to all the better, provinces that unlock retainers and units and stuff. But I would suggest number one, because, you know, it doesn't take that long to work your way over there, and you'll start with units that will enable you to win battles right away. So I would suggest starting with number one. But near the end, I'm going to pretty much go through the menus first, and then near the end I'll redo my avatar with number two, and I'll explain how to do it if you want to choose number two. But for initially, I'm just going to choose number one, which is what I suggest you do. Alright, now this is the next screen you're going to see. Again, if you want to change anything with your mon, I mean your flag, you're pretty much your battle flag appears over your units on the battlefield, you can do it by clicking on Edit Mon right there. This is your skill tree. Initially, you don't have any points to spend, but as your avatar progresses, pretty much every time you win a battle, you'll gain EXP. And as you gain EXP, you'll move up levels. There's 10 levels, 10 stars. You start with 0 stars. You start halfway through 0 stars. Once you get to here with the experience, once I get the 300 experience from 149, where I'm at right now, I'll move up to level 1. And then as I go through it again, I'll move up to level 2, and then level 3, level 4. And pretty much every time you go halfway through a level, and every time you go to the end of a level and progress to the next star, you'll get a skill point to spend in your skill tree. And you'll have up to 20 skill points to spend. So once you get to level 10, the highest you can get, 10 stars, once you get to 10 stars, you'll have all 20 points available that you can spend. And I'll go over where to spend your points initially a little bit later. A little bit later, once we go over some more the more basic topics, I'll explain where you'll get the most effect to, you know, by putting your first couple initial points. And then in the next video I do, the more advanced video, I'll show you the best way to upgrade your skill tree with, you know, all 20 of your skill points. But we'll do that a little bit later in this video, and then in the next video I'll show you how to do, you know, completely do the skill tree, the different ways to do it. Right here, your retainers, these are pretty much retainers are little things you choose that have an effect in the battles you play. So for example, if I use this retainer here, Famous Armory, that's +1 armor to all melee infantry. So if I put that retainer in, whenever I play a battle, all of my melee infantry now has +1 armor. This is a pretty basic thing. I guess I can discuss this first. In Shogun 2 Total War, there's a lot of good retainers, but in Fall of the Samurai, there's really not that many good retainers. And a lot of the good retainers you need to unlock, they're like random drops. You can't conquer them from the, you know, by conquering a province on the map. You'll just randomly get them after battles. The random drops are what they're called. From the retainers you start with, these are the retainers you'll start with. I would suggest using Modern Supply Corps +1 ammunition to all of your line and elite infantry. You'll rarely run out of ammo, but you know, out of the retainers you have, this is probably your best bet. I mean, unless you started with number 2 and you're not really using gun units, but you're using rush builds, then maybe use the Famous Armory to get an extra armor on all your melee infantry units. But if you started in position number 1 and your armies are going to have red bears in it, I would use Modern Supply Corps. If you started with position 2 on the map and, you know, you don't really want to use the White Tiger Force, so you're going to be obviously using melee troops, maybe throw in Famous Armory instead. An Experienced Gunboat Crew, this is a naval retainer, so this will have no effect in land battles, really. And the Clan Specialum retainer, pretty much just gives you, when you fight a match-made battle, it'll give you an extra 5 points on the clan map. It doesn't really affect you. It might help out your clan if you're conquering provinces for your clan on the clan map, but really doesn't have any effect in the battle for you. So, yeah, let's just put in this retainer here for now. Now, clan tokens. These are things pretty much every time you fight a match-made battle, and I'll go over that a little bit later in the video, where match-made is and how to fight match-made battles. You'll get 2 clan tokens for a win and 1 clan token for a loss, and pretty much these will help you when, every time you get 10 or 20, you can use them to upgrade units even further. There's a special, you know, upgrades called clan upgrades, which you need to use clan tokens to upgrade them. Like, one upgrade on a unit will cost like 10 or 20 clan tokens, depending on what upgrade it is. The armor sets are just, you know, if you unlock certain pieces of armor, you'll be able to unlock extra retainers. So this just shows your different armor pieces you currently have. Now, let's just go over the different menu options. Like, right up here, you'll see all the different options. Well, first down here, you'll see a generated list of people, a little chat room here. You can talk. Hello. Hello. And, you know, here's some chat rooms you can go to. Here's a beginner's chat room, you know. Clan course. Here's a chat room for a clan that's trying to recruit people. You know, there's different chat rooms down here. Sometimes there's funny chat rooms. Every once in a while I'll see a chat room called Gay Sex Chat or something like that. You know, people will create funny chat rooms, and then there'll be like chat rooms towards a specific purpose, like, you know, a clan trying to recruit people, or a chat room specifically for beginners, like it says right here. Not too many people use the chat rooms. Like, on the chat user list right here, this isn't even all the players that are online at the moment. This is just, I don't even know how it generates this list, but it's just like, you know, a handful of the people that are online. It'll just randomly throw you into a list of other people for the, you know, the public chat room. It's not even actually all the people that are online. It's just a handful of them that it just threw you with for some reason. I don't even know how it calculates that, but yeah, chat rooms down here. Up here you see all the different options to navigate multiplayer. What you're in right now is this button right here, your avatar, and that's this page right here. Right next to that, you'll see the army selection screen. Click on that, and you'll be able to view the units that are currently available to you. So, if you start in position 1, you'll start off with red bears. And if you start off in position number 2, you'll have both of you start off with these three melee units, these two skirmish units, and this cavalry unit, no matter where you start. But if you start in number 1, you'll start off with red bear infantry, and if you start off in position 2, you'll start off with white tiger force, which is right here. We don't have that unlocked, but if you start off in position 2, you won't have red bears available. You'll have white tiger force instead, which is completely useless. I would really never use a white tiger force in an army, but a red bear is a feasible option, at least until you get white or black bears. Yari Ki, actually, people almost always use 4 Yari Ki in their army. The unit's capped at 4, you can't take more 4 of them. Normally people have them pretty heavily upgraded when they use them, but yeah, I would use Yari Ki in your armies as your cavalry unit, your cavalry contingent, right away. Now, for the melee infantry you used, if you started with number 2, you'd pretty much be forced to use, you know, alright, say if you started with number 2, you can't use the white tiger force, so you're going to be forced to use, alright, 4 Yari Ki cavalry, and then some melee units. I wouldn't use Yari Kachi, really. I would use Katana Kachi. Let's see, we can afford. Yeah, so that would probably be your first army. That would probably be the army you would use for your first battle. 5k, your first 5k battle, 4 Yari Ki, 2 Katana Kachi, and a spear levy. That's if you started in position 2. But if you started in position 1, you have red bears, a gun unit, which is perfectly feasible to use. So you could use red bears in your army instead. Let's see, maybe something like this for your first battle. That could work right there. So this is why it helps you to start in position 1, because you'll start off with red bears. Now, if you go click on this screen right here, you'll see veteran units. Currently don't have any yet, but pretty much what will happen is after every battle you play, let's say I play a battle with these units right here, the unit that gets the most kills, as long as it got at least a certain amount of kills, after the battle you'll have the option to turn it into a veteran. And when you turn it into a veteran, you know, every time you can use it in your armies unless it's depleted, and you know, it'll keep count of how many kills it gets, and as it gets more kills, it'll get more levels, and as it gets more levels, you'll be able to spend more points on it. And pretty much what it does is when you spend a point on it, like, you can increase a stat, like you can increase, say if it's red bear, you can increase its reload or its accuracy. And you know, each time you upgrade, you know, spend one of those points, it'll cost more though. So you'll increase its reload speed by 10 for the price of an extra 50 Goku each battle. So it'll cost, instead of 800, it'll cost 850, and it'll have 10 extra reload on its stats. So that's what pretty much veterans are. There's also some veterans that aren't even available in your regular unit list. They're like almost like hero units. You'll get one of them, and only one of them, and like the Marine units, or the Samurai hero, a bow cavalry, which a Samurai hero is a bow cav, which no one really ever uses, but the Marine units people use a lot, and well, I'll go over them more in the advanced video, but Marine units you can unlock on the battlefield, I mean from the Avatar clan map, conquer certain province, get, you know, you'll get the unit. There's three Marine units available, so yeah, you can get, all the veteran units are composed of those hero units, the Marines and the Samurai hero and stuff like that, and then regular units which you turned into a veteran after a battle. So that's this screen right here. Oh, also there's the fleets. If you're playing naval battles, this will show you all the ships that are available to you. And when you're playing naval battles, there's no veteran ships. So unlike with land battles, you have veteran units. You don't have veteran units in your fleet, just regular units. And I would not play naval battles until you get this ship right here unlocked. So you'll conquer the heavy ship provinces, which unlock heavy ships, ironclad ships. And once you get the Kotetsu class ironclad, this $5,000 ship right here, then you can start playing naval battles. Until you get this ship right here, I wouldn't even bother. Most people, it's such an overpowered unit for its price. It dominates naval battles. Pretty much it's the same ship that your admiral ship is, actually. So you'll always start with one of them, your admiral ship. And then a lot of people, they spam these ships. They'll use nothing but these ships. So like in a 10k naval battle, they'll use two of these ships and then their admiral ship, and that'll be their entire army. You know, other people like me, you know, I'll always use one or two of them. So say it's an 18k battle, I might take one more Kotetsu class, and then I'll take a 10k Roanoke, and then I'll take, you know, three wooden corvettes, or maybe a wooden corvette and a torpedo boat. I do it a bit more balanced, and I can still compete with it, and I can still win with this army, but some people, they just straight up spam Kotetsu ships. I mean, and that option's there for you if that's what you want to do. It's probably the best option you have, but if you got a little bit of, you know, more noble mind, I would try not to go so spammy on the Kotetsu ships. But yeah, right here, if you want to win naval battles, unlock that ship right there, and then you can start playing naval battles. I'll also do another video later on, maybe later in the week, a tutorial video for naval battles, and I'll show you how to win without spamming Kotetsu ships. I'll show you different ways to, you know, and I'll also just give tips in general on how to play naval battles. It should be pretty helpful. A lot of people don't even know how to play naval battles. All they do is land battles. But yeah, that's this menu right here. So right here you got the avatar menu, stuff we went over. Here's the army menu, stuff we went over. Right here is your profile menu. It'll show all your stats, and it doesn't always show them correctly. Like, let's see. Right now it's showing my correct 1v1 rank. It's not showing my correct 2v2 rank or my correct 3v3 rank. It's showing my correct 4v4 rank. So it's not always correct in your profile, but gives you a gist of a person. You can actually click on a person's profile by going in here as well. So like, you'll go click on someone, you click this button right here. Click this to, you know, mute communication with them. Click this to go to their Steam page, which will open this up, and then it'll open up their Steam page. And then if you want, you can go over here and send them a friend request, or you can invite them to one of your groups. You know, that's how you do that. And but if you want to go to their profile, you'll click this, and then it'll go to the person's profile. So, oops. So that's that. It also doesn't always, like, it doesn't show the correct stats for, like, it's supposed to show the best ladder placement you've ever had, which isn't really what it does. It's buggy. It's buggy is the best way to say it. Like, for naval right now, it's showing my current rank, like 6,581, but I was actually in the top 20 or top 10 of the naval leaderboard at one point. But then I stop playing, and then if you stop playing, in any of the leaderboards, say you stop playing 1v1 naval match made, you know, after like 2 or 3 weeks, if you haven't played any match made battles in that specific leaderboard, your points and rank will actually start dropping until you start playing it again. So for me, I was in the top 10 of the 1v1 naval, but then I completely stopped playing, you know, 1v1 naval battles, and then, you know, over the course of a couple months, my rank just dropped significantly. So, you know, I was at top 10 at one point, but it doesn't show it in the profile. So this whole thing's a bit buggy, but, you know, just take it for what it is. Could, you know, deal with it. If it's not showing your correct stats, don't get mad about it. It's just, you know, it's buggy. Best way to explain it. This map here, I'll go over this in this big button right here in a little bit. Let's go over... let's go to the leaderboards. This button right here is the leaderboards. It'll show the leaderboards for all the different, you know, it has a 1v1 leaderboard for land. Here's the land leaderboards, here's the sea leaderboards. You know, 1v1, 2v2, 3v3, 4v4 leaderboards. You can, you know, click this to go to the top of it. Click this to show your position. And they just have it for everything. They have it for, you know, 1v1, 2v2, 3v3. You know, you can search for a specific player, if you know you want to check your friend's rank, type in his name. I'm just typing in my name right now, but, like, say you want to search for a specific person, you type their name in, and then it'll find out where they are in the leaderboard. Or again, you can just click on your name, I mean click on my position, and it'll show you where your position in the leaderboard is. That's not correct. Yeah, there I am. So it shows your different positions. Click top segment to go to the top. Click my position to go to where your position is. Again, it's a bit buggy. Like, still, for example, here I am 3. If I click my position, though, it shows me a different, completely different one. But yeah, that's the leaderboards right there. If you click on clan page. Oh, well, I'm currently in a clan right now. I'll leave it, though, just to... Alright, say you've never chosen a clan yet. When you click clan page, this button right here, this is the page you're going to see. And what you're going to see on the right is a list of all the public clans, the largest public clans, so you can join any of these if you want. Just click on it, and click to go to their Steam page. Then click join right here, and then you'll join the public group. And then once you join it, then it'll appear over on this side, and this is pretty much a list of all of your Steam groups that you've joined, and you can label any of them as your clan, as long as you're in the Steam group. So again, if you want to label one of these as your Steam group, the larger public groups, go to Steam page, join the Steam group, and then it'll appear in this list here. Then you click on it, and then you click label as my clan. And you definitely want to label a group as your clan. It'll enable you to get clan tokens, and it's just good. You want to label a clan. I actually have a group that you can label if you want. It's listed on the main page of my YouTube profile, so just go to the main page of my YouTube, and you'll see a link on the top right of the page. It'll say BadEgoGM Steam group. Just click on that. Or just type BadEgoGM into Steam, BadEgoGM, type it into Steam, and you'll find that Steam group, and you can join it, and then you can label it as your clan from here. So for example, right here, you'll just click on it. I'll click label as my clan. And then every time you click on this link, click on this right here, the clan page link, it'll open up this page now, which is pretty much your clan page. It'll show a list of all the people in your clan. It will, over here will be the statistics of your clan, you know, some more info up here. So this is your clan page right here. If you ever want to leave it, just click leave clan. If you want to visit the Steam group page, click the Steam group page. So that's the clan menu right there. Again, this is just another link like it had in the, you know, very beginning, to the Total War Encyclopedia, if you ever want to check that out. Now this right here, this is the Conquest map. Now this here is pretty much every time you want to move your marker around. Every time you win a battle, you will capture the province that your marker's on when you win that battle. If you win a land battle and your land marker is right here, you'll conquer this province, and then you'll unlock the either retainer, unit, or armor piece, or, you know, hat or pants, different things you can use for your avatar. That's what you'll unlock. If you're fighting a naval battle, you will unlock whichever province your ship marker is on. So if I win a naval battle, I will unlock this province. You don't get anything for unlocking naval provinces, just the naval province itself. You'll need to win some naval battles to get to the island. So say if I want this unit here, the Infantry Day Marine unit, I would need to conquer this sea province, and then I would need to conquer this sea province. And then once I have both of these conquered, it will let me move my marker over there. So for example, if you see, you can only move your marker to the adjacent provinces of provinces that you already own. And when you're first starting out, well, let's see, everything unlocks one of three things. It'll unlock everything, anything with a building on it will unlock a unit. So for example, this building here unlocks White Tiger Force. Or it will unlock, let's find one, it'll unlock a retainer. This one right here unlocks Uma Jinuchi something, I can't pronounce it. It's a retainer that gives +3 morale to your avatar. Or it will unlock, you know, an armor piece, or like I don't know what to call it. If you read this run right here, Modern Uniform 2, Modern Cap. If I captured this province, I would get an extra hat that I could use with my avatar. So when I'm messing with my avatar, if I conquer that province, I'll have an extra hat I can use. So those are all the things you can get from unlocking the provinces. Now, what I'd said earlier was you want to start with one. If you start with one, you'll start off right here with the province, this province right here, which gives you red bears. If you start with number two, you'll start off right here with this province right here, which gives you White Tiger Force. Now, you want to start off with number one because it'll give you the red bear gun unit, which you can use right away in your armies. And also, you'll be close to, if you conquer this province here and then this province right here, you'll get White Bear, which is pretty much a better bear unit. Pretty much of the white of the three bear units, Red Bear has the better, you know, attack and defense and stuff, and then Black Bear has the best reload and accuracy stats, and then White Bear is somewhere in between. Most people use Black Bears or White Bears. Hardly anyone uses Red Bears. But red bears are perfectly feasible for your first couple battles until you unlock white bears or black bears. So I would definitely start with number one. You'll be able to be competitive in battles right away. Whereas if you start with number two, you can't really use White Tiger Force. It's just such a horrible gun unit. You're going to be forced to use rush builds to stay competitive if you start with number two. So all right, let's assume you started with number one. Position number one when you created your avatar. I would first make your way over here. I would conquer this province here, then I'd conquer this province here to unlock White Bear, then I'd conquer this province here, and then this province here to unlock Black Bear. And then I would make your way over here. You want to make your way over here to pretty much this side of the map where all the better, you know, better provinces are. And in the process, pick up anything with a building on it, because that will unlock a specific unit. Also, pick up this province right here. It gives you a retainer, +3 morale to your avatar. That's probably one of the better retainers on the map that you can use right away in your armies. There's not really that many good retainers. Yeah, let's go over the retainers now, actually. Or no, let's go over, let's say if you started with position number 2 on the clan map, you'll start right here. And what I would do then is I would attack here, and then I would attack here, and then I would attack here. And this unit here will give you red bears. So it'll give you a gun unit you can actually use. And then I would go over here and attack this province, which would give you Black Tortoise Force, another gun unit, which is less powerful, but good for its cost. So both of these provinces gives you gun units that are feasible to use in armies. And then once you got those, I would make your way over here. I would attack this province or this province. and then I would attack this province here, which gives you a retainer that you can actually use. Bandit Horse Thieves and -5 charge enemy cab, and then I would attack this province, which gives you probably the best retainer that you can get from the clan map for Fall to Samurai, which is Practice Grounds, +2 melee attack for all cavalry units. Now, Fall to Samurai doesn't really have that many good retainer options, and most of the good retainers are random drops. Like, you can't get them by capturing a province on this map here. You'll just get them randomly after a battle. Like, they're called random drops. You'll just randomly get random drops, and you have no control over when you get it or what you get when you get a random drop. It's completely random. And most of the better retainers for Fall to Samurai are random drops. Out of the retainers you can get from the clan map, I would say the three best ones, in the order of how good they are, in my opinion, I would say Practice Grounds, +2 melee attack to all melee cavalry. It's the best you can get. And then the second best I would say would probably be Bandit Horse Thieves, -5 charge to all enemy cavalry. And then the third best I would say would be over here, right here, +3 morale to your avatar and his bodyguard. So those I think were the best three retainers that you can get from the clan map. It's not like in Shogun 2, vanilla Shogun 2, where the clan map actually has some decent retainers on it. There's not really that many good retainer unlocks on the clan map. Most of the better ones are random drops, which I'll go over. And I'll go over the random drops and the best random drop retainers, and you know, that you can use in your armies once you get them, in the next video I did, the more advanced video. But for this one, I'll just go over the basic retainers. So right there, the three retainers I discussed: Bandit Horse Thieves, Proving Grounds, and Umni, whatever, I can't pronounce it, Bearer, +3 morale. Those are the best three retainers. I would make your way to them on the clan map and unlock them and start using them in your armies. And your other options, once you're up to 10 stars, you'll have 5 retainers that you can use in your army. So obviously there's only 3 I just told you about, so you still have 2 more retainer options to use in your armies. I would use, on the clan map, these are some other retainers you can unlock. I'm not sure specifically where they are, but there's European Horse Trader, 5% speed bonus to all your cavalry. There's Spoiled Rations, reduced fatigue resistance to all enemy melee infantry. There's Livestock Pestilence, reduced speed to all enemy cavalry. And there's Hero Worshipping Boy, which is +2 hit points to your avatar. They're not really that great of retainers, but you need to use some sort of retainer. Out of the retainers that you have available to you when you unlock, you know, the whole clan map, those are probably your next best choices beyond the 3 I already told you about. You know, you still need to choose 2 more in your army. I would choose 2 of those 4 retainers I just told you about, probably Horse Trader, Spoiled Rations, Livestock Pestilence, or Hero Worshipping Boy, at least until you get some good random drops. Then you can start using the random drop retainers in your army, which I will go over the random drop retainers in the next tutorial video I do, the more advanced one. So let's see, is there anything else I need to go over here? I explained all the menus, I explained the retainers, I explained what to use in your armies for the first couple battles you do. If you start here, okay, alright, well I told you if you start in position number 1, you know, you'd use Red Bears and Yari Kais if your army. If you start in position number 2, you won't have Red Bears, so you'll have a useless White Tiger force, so you'd want to use a rush build if you're starting in position 2. Maybe something like that for your first battle. You know, you're better off if you had Red Bears, which is why I'd say start in position number 1, but if you start in position number 2, you might not have a good army to use for your first couple battles, but once you unlock Red Bears, go up here and unlock the Red Bears, you'll have the same as you would have started with number 1, except you'll be a lot closer to all of the better retainers. You have Proving Grounds and Bandit Horse Thieves and a lot of the better buildings. You're just a lot closer to all the more important buildings, whereas if you start over here, you gotta work your way over to all the better stuff, really. But I would still start with number 1, because your first couple battles, you'll actually have units that are feasible to win with. And yeah. That's it for that. Oh, okay. Now, as you progress through the levels, you'll get points to spend on your skill tree. Alright, so say I just went to level 1, you know, I have 1 or 2 points to spend. Where am I going to get the most bang for the buck for my points? Alright, well, pretty much you can't just upgrade something all the way at the bottom. Well, let me go to one of my other avatars to show you that, actually. Okay. Oh, wrong one. Alright. Also, if you ever want to redo your skill tree, like right now I'm going to redo my skill tree, it'll cost you 3 clan tokens to do it. So maybe if you don't want to waste clan tokens, build it, you know, how you want it right off the bat. But for your first couple points, alright, your first point, where am I going to get the most from my first point? Enable the gun, that's where you're going to get the most for your first point. Because this will give your avatar a gun, which he can get kills with, which will just be able to, you'll be able to use that right away. So your first point I would put to enable the gun, and then your next 2 points I would put into improve aura, which will give your general's aura rate, like a wider aura radius, so it'll affect more units around it, you know, with the morale bonus it gives it for just from its presence. Alright, and then for your 4th and 5th point, I would put them in reload right here. And then for your 5th and your 6th, I would probably do accuracy. And then after that, I would start putting in the melee tree. You know, charge, and then, you know, either attack or defense, one or the other. And then once you get a whole bunch more points, what you can do is you can click this button right here. I'm not going to waste more clan tokens doing it. I can just exit out and then go back in. Once you get, like, you know, 10 or, you know, more points, redo your skill tree and then go heavily into one specific skill tree. You know, Command or Bushido. I'm going to go over this more heavily in the advanced, the next tutorial video I do, so if you want to know how to upgrade your skill tree once you've got more skill points, watch the next video. But if you're just starting out and you're just spending your first couple points, put the first one to enable the gun, put your next 2 into the aura radius, put your 3rd and your 4th into reload, 5th into 6th into accuracy, and then your next couple into the melee tree somewhere. Charge, and then either melee attack or melee defense. That's where you want to put your first couple points in the skill tree. That's where you're going to get the most bang for the buck. And that's what I suggest you do. And also, click on the conquest map. It'll bring up 3 other menus right here. Now, if you click on this right here, this is match made. Pretty much, it'll just randomly pair you with another person. If you have land checked, it'll randomly pair you with another person in a land battle. Chess, click C, it'll randomly pair you with another person in a naval battle. You know, you can, you know, have both of them checked if you don't mind. You want to play sea or land, you don't care which one, it'll just randomly pair you in one of them. And, you know, say you only want to play a siege battle, just have that checked, etc., etc. Auto team means there's a possibility it might merge you with another person to play a 2v2 against another team or a 3v3 against another team. If you only want to play one-on-one, don't have that checked. Campaign drop-in means it might drop you into someone's single-player campaign and you'll play as the AI army in that battle. So those are the options available. Also, if you click allow mixed avatars, that means, you know, say you're a Fall of the Samurai avatar, you might get matched with a Shogun 2 avatar. So that's how, and pretty much, and setup teams the same thing, but this is what you use if you want to play with a specific team. So say I want to play with a teammate. I will send him an invite. Invite to game right here, this button right here. I can do it through Steam, or I can do it by, you know, invite friends, and then find them on my friend list here. And then you invite them. Once they join, they'll show up like right here. You'll click the options you want, what you want to search for, and then you'll click search. So that's how you play team games. This is how you play 1v1. And this is how you do battle list. This will take you to a list of battles you can join. These are a bit different than matchmade. The difference is when you play a matchmade battle, it's random. It'll randomly pair you against someone. The computer will pick who you play against, and it's completely random. And when you win a matchmade battle, you gain all the things you would win as if you had won a battle list battle. If you had won something in the battle list, everything you'll gain as if you had won a battle list game, except you'll get a couple extra things. One, it'll count towards what the specific leaderboard. So if it's a 1v1 match made, it'll count towards the 1v1 leaderboard. And it will also give you clan tokens. Those are the only two differences between battle list and matchmade. In matchmade, you'll get clan tokens if you win, or if you lose too, you'll get clan tokens for playing matchmade battles. And it will count towards the leaderboard. But they both count towards, like, say if you win a battle in either of them, you'll unlock whatever province you're on. And if you win a battle in either of them, you'll gain EXP towards your avatar. And if you win either of them, you stand just as likely as a chance as turning a unit that you used in the battle into a veteran after the battle. And your veterans will gain more EXP towards their next level as well. So you gain everything the same from each of them. The only difference, matchmade counts towards the leaderboard, and you get clan tokens. So there's the difference. When you're first starting out, I would suggest using the battle list. Oh, and another thing, if you do matchmade, it'll be one of three different fun levels. It'll be 5k funds, 10k funds, or 14k funds. And that is dictated by the lowest level avatar in that battle. So, say, like right here, you're level 0. It will be a 5k battle. If you play matchmade, all of your battles will be 5k because it's dictated by the lowest level player, and you'll probably be the lowest level player. And pretty much what it is, if the lowest level player in the matchmade battle is 0 to 2 stars, it'll be 5k funds. If the lowest level player is 3 to 6 stars, it'll be 10k funds. If the lowest level player is from 7 to 10 stars, it'll be 14k funds. So the fun level is dictated by the lowest level player in the game. What I would suggest, though, unless you're really confident that you'll do well, I would suggest doing battle list games first. And I'm going to actually show you an example battle and an army you can use. So, okay, let's say I start in position number 1. Remember what I said, make your way towards the black bears and the white bears and the black bear gun unit. So I got to conquer this province first before I can get to this province here, which will unlock the white bears. I would suggest doing battle list first. You can join a battle list game here, but I wouldn't do that because most people, they'll be hosting, 10k, whatever fun battles. What you want to do is, since you don't have that many units available to you, if you played a 10k or a 14k battle, you'd be at a huge disadvantage because a lot of the other players, they'll have a lot more units available to them, whereas you have a very limited selection. So you really need to do 5k battles when you first start out to win. You're going to have a difficult time winning anything other than 5k battles. So let's just host a battle here. I will call it 5k fun. Hopefully that will bring someone in. Classic battle will be, don't do classic battles. It doesn't count towards your avatar, I don't think, at least. Pretty much classic battles, you'll choose a faction, you'll have all the units available to you, but you won't be able to use your veterans. It won't count towards your it won't give you experience. I don't think it'll let you capture provinces from it. It's just another option, another fun option that you can test out and play if you want. It doesn't count towards advancing your avatar, though. Mixed avatars means it allows people with regular Shogun 2 avatars into the battle. So that option's, you know, available to you as well. I think for my example battle, I want to play another Fall of the Samurai opponent though, so I'll leave that unchecked just for this one. Normally I always have mixed avatars checked because I don't really mind. Yeah, and you shouldn't either, because if you play against a Shogun 2 avatar, he's kind of at a disadvantage. Because gun units are so powerful, you know, it just puts Shogun 2 armies at a huge disadvantage. And when you host the battle, again, right over here, you'll see your retainers. If you want to make any adjustments to your retainers, you can do so right here. If you want to change it to a naval battle or siege battle, you can do so from here. We want a land battle. If you click on here, you can change the map. You can go through the maps and choose something you want. Let's just do for this battle, let's see. What's a map I like? Boop, boop, boop. There's a map I like, I can't find it though. Kawabi River. I kind of like this map for some reason. I don't know why. So pick a map you like. The fun level right here, where you want to do small. Do small. You don't want to do medium or large because, you know, if your opponent has more stars than you, he has more units available, it puts you at a big disadvantage. But you can still compete in small funds. So you want to do small funds. Season is not really that important. Key buildings are buildings on the map that if you capture the building, actually, when I did that, it changed the map. I gotta change it back again. Key buildings are pretty much buildings where if you capture them, if you capture the building on the map, it will give extra stats. So if you capture the Morale Dojo, it will give you +2 morale to all units in your army. If you capture the attack dojo, it'll give you +2 attack to all units in your army. So the dojos are pretty important. Each one does something a little bit different. If you click your mouse over the dojo on the map, you'll be able to see what exactly it does. And to capture it, you need to have a dismounted, either a melee or a gun unit, some kind of foot unit, within the radius of the dojo, and then you'll start capturing it. Once, you know, the bar goes all the way up, it'll be captured and then in your possession, and then your units will benefit from that, whatever the effects of that specific building is. Alright, well, enough about the key buildings. You're gonna build an army here. And your army is going to consist of, or it should, Yariki Cavalry and Red Bears. So let's just do this. That's good enough for me. Let's do that. Alright. So here's an army you can use. 3 Yariki Cavalry, 3 Red Bears, 1 Spear Levy. You can compete with an army like this. So let's do this. Now the main advantage you have against people with more stars, they have more skills on their skill tree, but your avatar, look, he costs $0. Every time you put a point, every time you get, you know, advanced to the next level, your general costs more. So your general costs less, which means I can have more units in my army than my opponent does. So that's your main advantage. Obviously your disadvantage is you have less units available to you, less veterans available to you. There's a lot of disadvantages, but you have the advantage of your general costing less. You have more units in general in your army. And as long as if you start with number one, you have the Red Bears and you have the Yariki Cavalry. Both of them you can use in your army for a pretty effective army, which is what I just did right there. So let's play this battle. Alright, now the battle's loaded up. Right here is the button you click to click start. Right here is the force ratio bar, the timer. Over here is your retainers. Right here is all your retainers, and right here are any retainers that your opponent is using that's being played against you. So right here we see Flogging Officer, which is a random drop. All of my line and elite infantry has -1 morale, so all my red bears right now have -1 morale. Right here you can deploy anywhere within your deployment zone. This box right here, you can't deploy outside of that. The red is the deployment zone of my enemy, this red box right there. These are the key buildings I was talking about. One right here, one right, oh actually that's not one, that one's not in. There's two key buildings on this map. This key building here, this key building over here. They each do something. This is the reload dojo. Capture this, all of your gun units will have extra reload. Capture this one right here that increases stamina and movement speed. Capture this, you'll increase the movement speed and stamina of all your units. So each of them do a specific thing. Now for this specific map, normally I would deploy along this area here, but the reload dojo, the most important dojo on this map, I really want to capture that to give my red bears extra reload, so I'm going to actually advance along this side of the map. I got 24 seconds to deploy, I'll just put them up here. Normally you want to spread your units as thin as you can. I got them a little more deeply spread just so, you know, I want to deploy all the way over here. I'll move them down then. I'm going to take one of my cavalry, put them right in the corner because I'm going to run them up and I'm going to dismount and capture the dojo with them right away. Alright, timer ran down. We're starting. Let's get that one cavalry unit I was talking about right in here within the radius of the dojo so I can dismount it and start capturing it. Let's get my other cavalry somewhere around here. Same with my bodyguard. Let's get my spear levy up here as well. Once my spear levy gets on that dojo, I'll remount my cavalry. And let's just spread my gun units something like this for now. And let's check out our opponent's army. He actually has an Armstrong gun. And he sort of got his units boxed up. Alright. Well, so much of that. We're just going to be making our way forward into our opponent. So, all my units, I'll just start moving them towards him a while. I'll keep my spear over this way, because if he hits my dismounted cavalry unit, it'll actually scatter the cav, and then it'll stay a dismounted unit. So I'm pretty confident he's a new player. He probably won't target my dismounted cav. I don't think he's probably smart enough to do that. So I'll just go ahead and dismount him. Actually, he is targeting it. Ah, see what happened? Looks like I got one more spear unit now. Whoops. I didn't think he would, but he did. Darn it. Oh well. I'll just leave that unit to capture it then, I guess. We're gonna move our cav up a while. Actually, we'll want our cav on this side, I think. I'll take my cav over and I'll approach him from behind over here, and then I'll just line up my guns probably somewhere around here. Have my gun line right around here, and I'll just bring my cavalry in from there. Probably what I'll end up doing. I'm not even worrying about the stamina dojo. It helps, but doesn't help that much. He's gonna be doing some damage to my troops coming in, so normally I would walk him to help them you know, fatigue slower so they don't fatigue. But I'm not too worried about it because he has an Armstrong gun, so I want to close that distance as quickly as I can so his Armstrong artillery piece doesn't do too much damage. I want to, you know, close the gap with him as quickly as possible. Bring my cabin behind him. At this point, I'm going to save you some time. I'm just going to go ahead and skip in the battle until where my gun units are right around here and my cav are set up behind them. So I'll just skip ahead in the battle. Alright, now at this point I'm pretty well set up. One of my gun units and another one have taken some pretty heavy casualties, but I don't want to do anything dumb. When you're facing artillery, you don't want to overreact. You want to just take the casualties, get into position. You don't want to go prematurely sending in your cavalry, trying to get rid of the artillery. Just take the damage, get yourself set up, and then when you're ready. So right now I'm ready. I'm going to advance my gun line into range so they can start firing. I got my spear set up in the corner here. I'm going to go ahead and charge those into that artillery piece or maybe the gun unit behind it. I'm going to get this cavalry right in here where it won't get shot. I can bring this cav in a while because there's no gun unit facing it. This one, I'm going to wait until this gun unit gets turns around. I can bring him a bit closer. He's not quite into range or anything. You can see all my gun units, except for this one, are in range. My spears are going in. I'm going to send in my bodyguard as well. I'll hit his rally when he gets close to this spear unit. Oh well. I'm going to send my cav unit right here into his general. Got my general going into that cav unit. I'll start charging this cav unit in a while too. Because once my gen hits, it should disrupt that unit right there. Yep, see this unit's reforming, so here comes my cav to hit that unit. And that's pretty much, looks like he's drop packing me maybe. Frozen. Yeah, I think the guy is drop hacking me. Well, welcome to another experience of Shogun 2 Total War. This is something you'll run into a lot. If the battle freezes, it probably means the opponent has disconnected his internet and then he's reconnected it. And see, pretty much this is a cheat people do where they disconnect their internet and then they reconnect it, and pretty much it'll get dropped out of the game and they'll still get points for the victory. What'll happen is you'll both get points for the victory. You know, it's just a cheat. Don't even worry about it. If it happens to you, don't sweat it. People like these, they're low lives, they're cheaters, they're noobs, they're retards. Fuck 'em. Who gives a shit? Move on to the next game. If someone does drop hack you though, you'll still get clan tokens, you'll still get, you know, points for the victory, you'll still get the province on the map, you'll still get all the good, you know, all the goodies. It's pretty surprising because this was a battle list. Normally people only drop hack in match made because they're worried about, you know, losing their leaderboard rank or whatever other crap they're worried about. You don't really see it too often in battle lists though, so that was pretty funny that that person decided to drop hack me there. Bit amusing. I mean, but he doesn't really lose anything from it. You know, if he drop hack, he'll gain you know, the province and experience points, but he doesn't really gain that much by drop hacking someone in leaderboard, in battle list. I think it's amusing. But anyways, I'm just gonna show you the ending screen now and show you, you know, one of my units will hopefully be turned into a veteran. So, let's just skip ahead to the ending screen at this point. Alright, and this is the ending point. You can see, this is the ending screen, as you can see. The experience is going up. I gained 248. It's pretty slow, you know, everything moves slowly. You can go ahead and just click this button to go to skip to summary. Now, like I said, right here, the unit that got the most kills have the option to turn it into a veteran. Right here, Red Bear Infantry, I'll click accept to turn that into a veteran. Over here you see everything that you got. You captured the province that my marker was on, you captured the retainer that, you know, that province unlocked, you unlocked an extra veteran slot, and you created a new veteran, that Red Bear I just accepted. And you also gained experience on the skill tree. So let's go ahead and alright, so if you go to your skill tree, you now have 2 points to spend. Remember what I said earlier? First point in to enable the gun, and then the next 2 into improved aura. So you just spent some skill points. And you also now, if you go to your army screen, go to your veterans, you have a new veteran unit. And if you want to know how to upgrade your veterans, this is going to be basically what the majority of what the next tutorial, the advanced tutorial, is going to be about. Upgrading veterans and what the best random drop retainers are, and just more advanced topics. I will say, though, for now, until I come out with and you watch the next tutorial video, with a gun unit, you can't go wrong with upgrading reload speed. Any gun unit, you can upgrade reload speed. And any melee unit, this goes for melee cav as well as melee infantry, you can never go wrong with upgrading melee attack. So gun units, you can upgrade the reload a while. Melee units, you can upgrade the attack a while. Those are the best upgrades for both of those units. So you can use that advice for now until you watch the advanced video, and I explain how to best upgrade all the different units, which is going to be the main gist of what the advanced video is about. Because most people are, their armies will be consisting of mostly veteran units. Veteran units upgraded a specific way. That's going to be the cores of most high-level players. All veteran units, or the majority of it, veteran units. So you want to watch that video, because as you get more veterans, progress through the levels, when you get to the more advanced stage, you're going to be using armies consisting of veteran units. So you want to make sure that you upgrade in the correct way. And in the next video, I'm also going to discuss the best random drop retainers. So as you start getting random drop retainers, you'll be able to know which ones are the better ones. I'll go through and I'll explain, sort of like I explained the best retainers you get from the clan map, I'll explain the best of the random drop retainers. So as you get them, you'll be able to start using them in your armies. I'll just go over a lot more advanced topics, so keep an eye out for that next video. I should have it up in the next couple days, or if you're watching this video months from now, that video is already out, so just go ahead and watch it, and I'll probably stick a annotation with a link to it in the video once it's out, so you can just click on your screen and go watch video number two. Thank you for watching, and I really hope that I was able to help you out somehow here. If you have any questions at all, don't hesitate to comment this video with your question, and I will answer it for you to the best of my ability. So shoot me any questions you got in the comments, and I really hope I helped you out, and thanks for watching.